I'm gonna send this to you. I'm gonna put it in the chat and you just click it.
All right, man.
Episode 45 of the Critically Unfocused Podcast. Don't click this shit and like close your chat window though, like your thing. But just look at the picture.
On the computer. Okay, I thought you were talking about like in the.
You were sending us freaky pics of Eddie George, okay? Oh, wow. Look at him. That actually is kind of a freaky pic. Where did they take that at?
That's hilarious. Not
in his new job.
Yeah. Eddie George carpet. Why do they have a red carpet picture of Eddie George in a jersey? He had like a 15-year career. That's a red
carpet picture, right?
It looks like it.
Like a Sunday ticket event. It says like the DirecTV logo.
Yeah.
Behind.
Hey, Eddie, can you come and run on screen for us for a little bit, bud?
Oh, my God. You licked his lips first.
Oh, brother.
The funniest picture I ever seen is that one for like that old Atlanta Falcons safety, his college picture where he's like this and he got the football between his feet.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
That's the funniest football picture ever.
He took the senior picture.
I can't believe that. Jesus, man.
What's going on? What's number 45? What's up?
4-5, the big 4-5.
Yeah.
What's good? What's good, guys? It's been a while.
For you.
Who am I talking about? I ain't talking about you. I hate you, nigga. I had to take a little sabbatical, but I'm back. Back to kick some ass. You guys have no idea how infuriating it is to listen to your niggas talk that when you can usually yell at them and they say something you disagree with. I'm in the car like, Todd Bowles didn't have draft power, nigga. What are you talking about? Just be mad at myself. Got to text you 4 days later. Shit don't even hit the same. Just like,
Yeah, I was trying to. Damn, well, I forgot what we was talking about last. But I remember you'd have had my back for something we was debating last.
It was the Todd Bowles thing.
Probably it was. Yeah, he got shafted.
Hey, but I'm back. We jumping Blake again.
Yeah, man.
We bite.
Are we gonna start there?
No.
You won't talk about your week for nothing like that.
No, that's part of my week is telling you how much I hate you when you're not around.
All right.
But I'm back. I did miss you guys. I missed the fans. You know, the game. I don't know if they still love me. I gotta come back and put up a triple double today. I'm ready.
Hey, man. I feel like I'm in a handicap match right
now. Yes, you are.
I like to congratulate you on your recent winnings.
Bro.
You got the win.
You bagged up?
Hey, double bagged up. Hey, I haven't lost a bet in 2022 is all I'm going to say. It's a new year, new me. Definitely not losing any bets in Black History Month. I'm about to go on a fucking roll.
Damn. We can't lose a Black History Month.
Fuck no. Which means I'll probably lose tonight. But, you know, I'm going to give it a shot.
I didn't think of that, though. We definitely got to turn up.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, man,
I'm glad you didn't bet on who's going to be the Jags' next coach. But anyway, yeah, man, how you guys been? How y'all week's been?
Man, it's been cool. Go ahead, Jamal. You been sitting?
Oh, no, nothing special, man. Just good. Just work. That's about it, really. Just working and shit.
How exciting.
Yeah, you know. Nah, nothing really. I don't really got nothing.
Okay.
Man. Okay. Well, I got stuff to talk about for my week. I'm realizing in life, like, I have an issue where if I look at something long enough, then like I can't stop myself from getting it. And that's how I ended up with this new screen.
Monitor my ass.
I know. I was gonna say monitor, it's just a TV. But damn, I don't even know where this is looking at now. Whatever. But like, yeah, so I've done this same thing with before it's been with whiskey, it's been with like watches, it's been with cars, it's been with guns, like literally anything. Like I invest myself in that topic and then I end up buying something from it because I don't know, like I have like poor impulse control. But either way, so now like I have this giant ass screen in front of me and like my eyes hurt after a while, but it's so cool to look at.
Hey, you got to get you some of them blue light glasses. Them shits really help.
I have some. They're just in my... So I wore them at my last job at my desk and it was fine because like I kind of like slowly brought them in and integrated myself with them. But like just to show up with glasses one day at work is kind of just weird. So like I just haven't done it this time. And yeah. This room is way better lit than like where I used to sit. So that's cool.
What TV did you get?
Just the LG C1.
Sheesh. boy got the top of the top. That, hey, tell the fans you're rich without telling them you're rich. He was like, hey, I seen a Beamer and a C1. I bought them on the same day. Holla at your boy. Don't correct me.
But it's the thing. I look at the same thing over and over again. Like my car, I was looking at it for probably like over a year. Not that same one that I bought, but like the same model and everything.
Yeah.
So, I've been looking at this TV for probably like 6 months.
Yeah, no, I've heard nothing but good things about the C1. I can't wait to see that shit in person.
I did that on the Royal Rumble stream too with Jamal. I tried to drink something and I was talking to Brantley at the same time with you in the chat. And with water, like it's fine, but like when it's whiskey, like no. Burn your lungs up.
But are you enjoying? Have you like gamed on the TV or the monitor and all that? It looks pretty good.
Yeah, man, I've been like lives so up to I went to this because Steam had a sale going on, so I went and got picked up 3 games. I bought Shadow of War because I started that like 4 times but never finished it. It was like $7, so I was like, fuck it, whatever. It was looking kind of good. It doesn't really look good today, like today, because that came out a long ass time ago.
Shadow of War is the first of the two, right?
Shadow of War is the second, but like that came out like
fuck that game.
Yeah, that came out like probably 4 years ago at this point. Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah. Then I bought Tales of Arise, which is like it's cel shaded, so it don't look super crazy, but like the cutscenes that it does are like you're basically watching an anime, and that looks like fucking nuts. Nice. And then I already owned Total War Warhammer 2. And I've been playing that a bunch. It's an RTS game. I've tried to start it like a few times before, but I just couldn't get into it. I'd get my ass kicked, but I figured out now kind of how to play it. Like, I don't know if you guys are familiar with Civ, but like you don't necessarily have to get yourself involved in the live action battles if you don't want to. I just do things like I like favor diplomacy. Like I work with people, I build trade routes and shit like that. And then I build up my army, so that way, like, by the time I actually... You're laughing at me. That's fucked up. Let me speak Horizon. I do shit so that when I do get into a conflict, I can do the auto-resolve thing, and it I'd get away with, like, either winning it, like, handily or
peacefully.
That's the way to go if you get your ass kicked.
Nah, nigga. Yeah. I play those. We building our shit up, but we invade niggas and bringing back slavery.
Going to op. Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's different. So that's the funny thing. When you win a battle, you have 3 choices of what to do with like the people you defeated. And you can either ransom them, you can execute them, or you can force them into labor.
Oh, bet. Slavery, bet.
But so if you force them into labor, it helps your army recover and everything. So, but sometimes I don't need recovery, so it's...
Nah. Oh, shit.
Because you get experience for that. But yeah. So, the game's been hella fun. It's just, yeah, I don't do the live battle because I'd be fucking up. You have to, like, control, like, where your troops are stationed or in position on the map and stuff like that. Stop yourself from getting flanked. And, like, they just be fucking up. So, like, I don't do it. And then what else happened this week? Have y'all ever cooked with... Oh, no. So, staying with Best Buy, this is also the first time that I've had an experience in person with someone here in Fayetteville, like, fanning out over J. Cole. So, that was...
You saw
it? It was because... No. I didn't see him, but it was, like, because the people... There was, like, 2 younger dudes, probably, like, late teens, early 20s, who were at the little TV section thing where I got this. And, they had just heard the Benny and J. Cole song for the first time.
Oh, okay, got you. I thought like you saw.
And they were like, yeah, they were like, oh my god, dude, how can he rap this nice? Like this is crazy. Like every time you listen to this, think of something else, dog. Like he's really the goat. And I was like, man, I never thought I'd see it in person. This is crazy. But like here
it would be hella tight for your local rapper to be J. Cole or like your local rapper to be Kendrick or something like that.
Yeah, we got J. Cole and Moray out here.
Yeah, that's tight.
That's cool.
No love for Pablo.
He's not from Fayetteville.
Oh, never mind.
Damn,
I don't know where he's from.
Regionist.
Yeah. And then have y'all ever you know what a mandolin is?
Yes.
Kitchen item. You ever used one?
No.
So I bought one for us. What do you say, Jamal?
So that sounds. I'm about to Google it right now.
Okay, it's basically like this. this sliding knife type of shit. Like you slide like a vegetable, or you can do meat on it too. But like you slide it and it cuts like thin slices, thick slices, but it's a really sharp blade like on a board that you're just sliding things into, and it puts the slices beneath it, right? Think of like a cheese grater, but like more so just like a blade on the thing.
Exactly what it looks like. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So we have one of those. I bought it for our house like around Christmas time. Not, it wasn't like expensive or anything like that, but I just thought it'd be neat because like we could like cook with a lot of vegetables, and like that's a quick way to slice a bunch of shit really fast. Either way, when I bought this, I made a joke to Bree because she always is the one that like cuts her fingers on shit when she's cooking.
Oh, fuck.
So I bought like an anti-cut glove, right? So who do you think wore the anti-cut glove when they used it this week?
You.
Not me.
Oh. Oh, you cut your finger out. Oh, no.
Yeah, I sliced my thumb on that shit. And then I did that and I was putting it away, I was looking in our cabinet and there's a piece that you can put on top of it so that holds the food down that you're slicing. So that way your hand doesn't have to be there and you can't cut your hand.
Dumbass. Like,
I just saw it as a piece of plastic. I wasn't thinking what it was until afterwards. And I was like, yeah, God damn. Glad you, it could have been so much worse. I was pressing down really hard.
Oh.
Yeah.
Did it just take like a chunk out?
It was a little tiny piece. And it honestly didn't even hurt because I think the thing was so sharp. Like, so. Yeah. It didn't hurt at all. It was the weirdest thing. It just was bleeding.
I did that shit on a cheese grater once, and I wanted to cry, but I had people over, so I couldn't. That shit was fucking embarrassing.
Ooh wee!
Just took a whole chunk out my thumb.
Then what else? Did I have anything else that was life stuff that I was going to talk about? No, I don't think so. No.
All right. Wanna
get to the shits?
Let's get to the funnies or the not so funnies. Oh, 45s real quick. Donovan Mitchell, Kenny Easley,
something else,
and TJ Duckett. Those are the three I got. So Kenny Easley probably the best one. I don't
Michael know. Jordan.
You said Don. I was like, what?
I thought that too. I think you said Don.
I was gonna skip this episode. Hey,
Michael Jordan, you were 45.
Oh, that's true. That's true. What was Cheese eyes.
Doesn't what number does Devin White wear?
40? I think he wears 40. He might wear 45. You might be right.
Yeah, and then I know the I think the linebacker Deion Keanu Jones Neal. Wears 45 too, right?
Nah, Keanu Neal does.
Okay, what about Deion Jones?
He wears like 20 something, 22 or something like that. He's in Dallas now. Weird ass
niggas. No, yeah, the Devin linebacker for the 45. Falcons. People be wearing some weird ass numbers.
Yeah, that's Keanu Neal. Deion Jones plays for Keanu Neal plays for the Cowboys now. Deion Neal. Yeah,
Deion Jones doesn't wear 45.
Deion O'Neal. Well,
yeah, because he keeps talking about the same two niggas that neither one of them matter. Oh, no.
That's your favorite franchise player.
I thought there's somebody else that worked 45. I can't remember right now.
But you don't know him, so it don't matter.
Ooh, yeah. Nah, I'm thinking of Chris Cooley wore 47.
Not the number of the episode.
Yeah.
Nah, what position did he play?
He was a tight end for the Washington.
Okay, yeah, I remember now.
No, the Washington Commanders.
Oh, yeah.
Ain't the Commanders out here, boy. Let me tell you. These people out here, man, they're different. You know what? Like, so I overheard a conversation, I think it might have been yesterday, of them discussing, I don't know what they were discussing at first, right? But then they were like, yeah, I believe he lives a alternative lifestyle. And so in my mind, I hear that. I'm thinking like a hippie. But no, he didn't mean a hippie, dog. He meant, that's like the ignorant, polite way of like, discussing someone who's other than straight.
That's 100 times better than what I would imagine, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah. But
that's not
great, but it's better than I would imagine.
It's just funny.
Like, y'all are a different place.
Y'all can't get beside yourselves at all out here. It's crazy.
It's hella funny because folks really be like purposefully doing it too. Like, oh, no, mm-hmm. I don't even use a pronoun. Well, you go by he, right? No, I don't. Not anymore.
I heard that conversation today too because someone had I obviously like on things up where y'all are, it's pretty normal for someone to list their pronouns on shit, right? Mm-hmm. That's not a thing down here. And I guess someone did it like on an application or something today or on something like, and then maybe it was their signature block. And it became this whole conversation like, well, is it a dude? Like, what's their chromosomes and shit like that? And it, like, just assuming because of someone that put that shit down that they're.
What's their chromosome?
I don't know. Like, yeah, I don't know. I don't know a way to describe it without being problematic myself, so I'm gonna stop.
Yeah, nah, yeah. Don't get us canceled.
Love all y'all, for real.
That's funny.
Yeah, be a love who you want to love.
There's a there's like a TikTok video of this girl going around asking people like, "What's your pronoun?" And they'll be like, "I don't have a pronoun," or like, "I'm a nigga," or like just shit like that, where it's like you have a definition to your like what you want to be addressed by. I don't know. I can just call you bitch now because you don't got a pronoun. That's just what I'm gonna call you.
And that that's all it is. Is like when someone like they ask you like what your title is or whatever. Like so someone's like doctor, mister, or whatever.
Yeah.
Think of a pronoun the same way. It's just like, what do you want to be called? Like, that's it.
Yeah, people are funny. All right. What you got first for us, Blake?
So I didn't do a proper document. This week's been hell. But I'm obviously, I think the Brian Flores thing is going to be probably the bulk of what we talk about here. But I just got some other stuff before that.
Let's get it.
Did y'all watch any of the Senior Bowl stuff, or have y'all been keeping up with it? What's going on with that and everything?
No. I've seen Malik Willis knock over a garbage can from like 60 yards away, but other than that, I haven't seen nothing.
Holy shit. Okay. No, so I've been, other than like, because I shared a clip with y'all today of some lineman shit, but I've been like, that's been like the thing that's been popping up the most. And one of the funny things too is that like one of the channels with the most coverage of the Senior Bowl is the New York Jets YouTube channel. I think that kind of just says a lot about them as a franchise.
Like, they probably got the most people down there doing the most work. They probably
got their whole team down.
Hey, Zach, why don't you go down there and work out? Yeah. Go throw to some real receivers, bitch.
Yeah. But I thought that was funny. But then I was, I think earlier today, before I was watching the lineman video I sent y'all, like, it was supposed to be one-on-ones, and the old lineman was losing literally every time. And I'm like, is this like supposed to be this way? Or is this just like a really good group of D linemen or something?
I'm having a bad day.
Yeah, it's like, it's like,
what'd you say?
They had accountants up there.
How do you're just the best senior in the nation? It doesn't mean you're one of the best football players, right?
Like, and that's typically why I don't pay a ton of attention to the Senior Bowl, because they'll usually find like someone there, like somebody from a smaller school is going to be there, somebody will raise their stock. But like, if you're the left tackle there, you're probably the 17th best left tackle, and maybe not 17th, but you're not one of the like top five guys because you would have come out early. So it's like you don't really get the best of the best watching all that shit. You can definitely learn something, but all the younger cats is where the real shits is at.
Yeah, I think I like watching them go through drills and shit like that, because like it's hard for me to make an assessment of anybody just based on like watching them do the drills. But I just like watching football players go through those drills, the same drills that we all did and stuff like
for
that.
Sure.
Just seeing how they do it at that level.
Entertaining, for sure.
Lineman drills are one of my favorites to watch. Watching like a great defensive lineman just wreck offensive lineman over and over again is awesome. And watching a great offensive lineman just pancake shit is awesome.
That's why I was like so confused. I was like, dog, like, why is he losing this many in a row? Like, this doesn't make any sense. Yeah, it just might be how it is. There was this tight end from Colorado State, though, that was nice. Like, it's this big ass white dude, like Travis Kelce. Like,
nice. Yeah, see, those are the guys you'll find where it's like you're not necessarily paying attention for that person, but it's like, wait, who is this guy that you'll look next year and he's like a fourth round pick on a random ass team? It's like, oh, yeah, I remember him. Okay.
So no, he'd be cool RTE one today. I don't know where he's supposed to go, but he is nice.
Make a call, man. You probably got some pull down there. Did you see that they're doing a I don't know if you got it on your list, but you see they're doing a combine just for the HBCUs this year?
Oh, they got it.
At least they said it was the first annual. It looked like it was at Jackson State. I thought they had always had a separate one, but the video I was watching, they said it was the first one. Didn't have nothing crazy on there, but this was just the first time I'd seen them have one like just for HBCU guys. But I did think that they had one before, because I thought I saw one last year.
Maybe there's combines or whatever.
But they said they had people from all 32 teams down there. So maybe they had one before where it was like pro days, but not like an official send somebody from every team down here to see kids. A lot of them niggas they were showing look like us though. Like, hey, you're like not like literally like us, but just like a D tackle who's like 5'11", 260.
Yep.
Probably not going to league, but you know, get a look, get on a practice squad, make a little check. Sure, like most of the dudes look so regular. It was hella funny.
That's funny. Yeah. That's going to be the case. I'm going to try to make it to a game next year. I've actually been down and around Fayetteville State more this week than I have like in a long time. So I didn't realize how big that campus was. So I'm going to definitely try to make it to a game.
Is Is how far is North Carolina A&T from you?
An hour and 15.
You should go. Just go watch J.R. Smith golf. Go cheer him on.
He'll probably come down here to golf at some point. But
nice. Yeah. That'd be kind of tight to see him golf.
Yeah.
Like, yo, who's this nigga yelling, J.R.?
Earl! Earl!
What the fuck else? Oh, okay. This is a non-football thing. Did y'all see, I think this weekend, actually. Obviously, none of us watch NASCAR, but they're putting a fucking racetrack in the LA Coliseum. Like, there's a race in the LA Coliseum this weekend.
I did see that, yeah.
Yeah.
That, don't know why.
I'm going to check that out, even though I don't watch that shit, just because that sounds insane. I don't know how the fuck that works. I'm
trying to see. Yeah, how the hell is that going to work?
Yeah, how do you pit? Like, they showed the track. I was like, how the fuck do
you get out of it? You don't.
Yeah.
I feel like NASCAR... Because probably not anymore, obviously, because it's just being phased out in general. But when we went, when I went down to LA and went to SoFi and we did that stadium tour, so I guess the Inglewood Speedway or whatever the speedway was called down there was down there. Mm. And the black dude that was telling us is like 65. He looks so excited to be talking about NASCAR. And I think they're talking about building some sort of like raceway in that complex where like the Clipper Stadium, the Rams Chargers Stadium's out. There's going to be some sort of raceway down there. But I imagine NASCAR probably was hella big in LA at some point, just because all those black folks moved from the South, watched racing and shit all the time, and then brought it with them or had it come out there. Yeah.
It's a hard sport to maintain in terms of like keeping a venue alive, because like you need like a culture of racing period in order to do that. And like if that's not what that area is about, then it's not going to work. And like, especially not someplace that's like cramped for space like LA. Like down here in the South, like they'll you know, like how the Forum is still standing in LA, but like obviously the Crypt is there now. It's like that with NASCAR tracks down here. Like the old ones will still be up, and like some of them will just fall into ruin and still be up. Like I've been through Darlington, South Carolina a couple times, and like they have a new super speedway and then their old one's still up too. And that's a middle of nowhere empty ass town.
Yeah.
Where's the Indy 500 at? That's the
guess.
Is it out there? Is where you at?
Just guess where it's Indy. At.
Indy.
Oh, shit, I didn't think of that.
Motherfucker.
Where do you think, where's the Daytona 500? Where do you think that is?
Dayton, Ohio.
Like Miami.
How about Daytona, Florida?
No, I know it's a Daytona.
No, you don't. This brother, no, simple.
I didn't even think of the Indy one, though. Oh, shit. Damn.
That's a brickyard, man. Yeah, you got to kick the bricks, pour some milk on your face.
Hit the drop.
I just learned something today. That's
cool. Hit the drop. Hit the drop.
This thing's nuts.
Am I dropping right, working anymore?
Oh, brother. Okay. There we go. Thank you.
Damn, why is that drop?
On his face.
Oh, my bad.
If you see it,
it's not bad.
You get on your knees, you kiss the bricks, and then they come pour milk on your face. Yeah.
When you're on your knees, actually.
Yeah. Hit the drop. What do you mean? Mm-hmm. It's incredible. All right. Anyway, moving on before we get in trouble.
Is there anything else? The Pro Bowl skills competition shits, huh?
It goes on the end of the day. I didn't see any of it. I'll probably watch it on YouTube later, though.
Watch some YouTube videos, man.
Blake only sent us all five of the YouTube clips. I watched some of them. I didn't watch all of them. I watched some of the quarterback ones and watched some of the catching ones. I did see Jordan Jefferson win dodgeball, and then that was it.
Yeah, with the one-handed grab.
My boy. He's been the superstar. He just got everybody dancing all weekend. Every time I look up, another gritty video popping up.
And look at him. He's doing the gritty.
Hey, love it. I don't know if we covered it on here, but nothing's funnier than Adam Schefter doing the gritty and tearing his fucking meniscus. He works
that. That's crazy.
You got to stay in your lane, man. That's all that is.
He was doing it in fucking Ralph Lauren duck boots at that. He ain't got no kind of grip.
Let's take the LL Bean boys on.
Oh, my God. LL Bean boys. Grab a seat, old man.
Get your old ass out of here. Being blocked by Adam Schefter is the worst shit ever. You
being blocked by him?
Being blocked by him on Twitter is the worst. You see his name and then like you can't see his tweets. I'm like, damn, I gotta go check Rappaport and all of his tweets.
Well, maybe you shouldn't have called him a 9/11 cuck.
Wow, that's a good one. I wish I'd have said that.
Isn't that what you said?
Nah, I said something else.
Oh, something worse. Got it.
Nah. I'm just saying.
You don't got to repeat it. You don't got to repeat it.
He was a 9/11 opportunist. That's all I'm saying. If you know, you know. That nigga was riding around dodging looking
for second women. I feel like I should block you. What? That's fucked up.
What? He's the one fucking walking around debris looking for sad women.
Get the fuck out of here.
Damn, you, that's your husband under there? That's crazy.
Adam Schefter was just down there on 9/12, like, oh, who's selling pussy? Yeah.
Wow. Oh, no.
Jesus Christ. Damn.
Oh, my God. Crazy, man.
You're by yourself, huh?
That's I was crazy. Just there.
You just here by yourself, huh? Who's going to raise them kids for you?
You know, I have money. I'm on NFL Network.
All right. All right. Let's move on. Fuck get Michigan.
Out of here.
Yeah. Not I'm glad he has you blocked. That does got to be awful. Imagine being blocked by like Woj or something. You just can't see shit NBA related.
Yeah. Like, no. Man, if like, shout out to Ian Rappaport, man. If it wasn't for him, man, I'd be left out. Like, people be sending me like Adam Schefter tweets all the time. Like, nigga, I can't see that, bro. You got to screenshot. Wait,
you can't see it even if we text it to you. Right?
No, yeah, like if you guys like text it to me, I can see it. But like when people like send me like an Adam Schefter tweet, like a DM, it'll say okay. Adam Schefter / what? Dude, I can't click it. Like you're unable.
I'm about to just send you all kind of lies.
It's fucking annoying. You see,
Adam Schefter just said that fucking. Never mind. I'm not even gonna use it because I'm about to use that one tomorrow.
Yeah, no, that shit is frustrating. That's like one person I wish that like would unblock me. It's the only one. I don't give a fuck about anybody else.
I'll tweet him for you and see if he'll unblock you.
Nah, fuck.
Hey, man. Adam, my friend made fun of your relationship and your wife losing her husband in 9/11. But do you mind unblocking him so he can see when Trent Baalke gets fired?
Like, I promise you, he's very sorry.
he hasn't changed, but he is sorry.
Oh my God!
That nigga love destruction.
If you could take back what you said, so he was unblocked, would you do it?
Nah, I still get to do it anyway, so fuck it. I don't even fuck that dude. It's cool.
What did you gain from that?
Nah, I had some good jokes. And I got
why did you even well. Say it? Did he do something to you? Oh, you saw the E60 and you were like, I gotta go tweet this motherfucker.
Nah, like, so like, I remember I had an issue when like, I remember this like back in the day when like, somebody got out of jail. I think it was when Plaxico Burress got out of jail. He wouldn't like call Plaxico Burress like by his name. He was like referring to him as like to his like prison inmate number such and such and such.
Oh wow!
And I remember like other people were like saying like that's kind of fucked up. Like you know the person's name. You've covered him in the NFL. Don't be calling him his fucking prison inmate number and all that stuff. Like, that's a little
so racist. That's why you do that.
What?
You're just paying it back.
What?
What Ben Roethlisberger?
Oh, that's not even had nothing to do with that. I just like how he was talking about Plaxico, like he was referring to him as an inmate number. But nah, Ben Roethlisberger deserves to be in there.
Wait, I'm dying because Plaxico got out of prison in 2011. So Shakur has been blocked since like Adam Schefter started breaking stories, dog. Nah, he's never seen a good
since he got on Twitter.
we've been on Twitter since like 2008. Nah,
since maybe? Adam Schefter got on Twitter.
Yeah. Oh yeah. But no, like I didn't fuck with that. So then that's like I think I remember I don't know how I learned the 9/11 shit.
They did an E60 on him and they talk about it all the time on ESPN.
Yeah. I'm like, man, you wouldn't have your relationship now if you had to prey on some woman whose husband died a hero and you just swooped her up.
Wasn't her husband like an accountant?
His wife's husband.
I thought he just worked in the towers. I don't think he was a firefighter.
No, I thought he was a firefighter.
I could be wrong.
Something like that, right?
Wow. I did just look up the tweet, though. May 23rd, 2011, Adam Schefter tweeted, inmate number 09R3260, Plaxico Burress.
There were a couple NFL players that kind of had an issue with it. Because I remember, like, Darnell Dockett was going off on them about it, too. Like, that's bullshit.
I think, well, this is probably obviously biased just because we are of that generation. But I feel like there's been no faster shift in like what is culturally acceptable than maybe like the last 10 years.
Shit, the last five maybe. Well, 10's probably better. But yeah, for sure. For sure. I'm just 100% thinking how
Twitter was like in probably like 2011. You could still get some wild shit off. So that's how come I say like 10.
Yeah.
Because I got off of it in 2012, I believe.
Me so and Shakur.
I think y'all said it changed like promptly after that.
I wouldn't say promptly. Cool. It got better after that.
Changed like like, okay, maybe like five, like 4 or 5 years ago, you couldn't, like,
When did FTF stop?
That's what I was about to say. FTF was still around like 2014, 2015.
Well,
that's it wasn't as common, but yeah, it was still that used.
That just popped off when Rick Ross was saying it in that song. That's when it really came for. Because I looked at some
I feel like they was getting off before Ross, and then Ross threw it in there. Because like
I was about to say, I think FTF started on Twitter and Ross used
credit card scheme. That was for the
that was definitely because of that. Yeah.
Nah, I think he stole it from Twitter. Because I feel like when I first got on Twitter, I remember seeing people say that. I'm like, God damn. This
is But think impressive. About that. When you first got on Twitter, that's probably like when that shit came out. Because that's around when Teflon Don kind of came out. Like 08, 09-ish maybe.
Damn, that album had Money Make Me Come.
Teflon Don was 10, 11.
Nah, Deep in the Rap had Money Make Me Come on it, I think.
Oh, yeah. Teflon Don, we was at Cheney. That was like when the Big Boy album came out and Eminem's album came out. That was
at the same time too.
That was a hell of a summer. That was like summer 2010.
Yeah, but no, I swear that's when because I remember. Yeah, that was a wild hashtag. Yeah, Twitter used to be the Wild West, dude. That shit was crazy. Yeah.
I remember when Prince and his crew on there would do the, goddamn, what did they call it? But they would like expose people on Fridays. And the whole entire week, they'd be like, oh, we got some shit coming for
him. I remember that.
What was that website? The little live streaming website. Not Tiny Chat. Was it Tiny
Periscope?
Chat? Oh, no. I was never in that. The only time I joined one of those was for the Waka Flocka concert. But they just would do it like on the timeline.
Yeah, I remember
that. Chick had like the Colombian flag or whatever, and they found out like she was like a bot or some shit. Like, she wasn't real. They got her out of here. Then they had that Relly dude in his Ugg boots. I remember that.
Oh wow, I remember
Relly. No, they used to low-key ruin people's lives on there.
I think Relly's he's in jail.
He got locked up he had like 500 pounds of weed on him or some wild shit like that.
Oh, that's why he got locked up for weed?
Yeah, it was weed and other drugs, I think. I think he had like multiple types of drugs. Now, they used to like
a little bit too early.
They used to put people like, oh yo, we found out this nigga's wife looks like this and he been talking wild about y'all, you're out of here. Oh, we found out you don't pay child support, you're out of here. Like, god damn, niggas is
like doxing people. I remember no, actually on the Button podcast, Ice will be talking about like his old like Twitter terror of Dave and like how like he baited people into putting their iPhones in the microwave for like wireless quick charging and shit.
Yep.
All that trolling he used to do. Like he asked Michael J. Fox if he's gonna do the mannequin challenge, I guess.
And Michael J. Fox on it was like, come on, man.
Yeah.
I remember when I think what was it? Like somebody said he got stripped butt naked in Philly and they didn't even have guns on him.
I think Pusha T said that.
So yeah, about Ice.
Yeah. I will say
maybe someone like have a nigga strip you butt naked and don't have a gun on you is crazy. Or like they don't have a gun.
Some people don't want that pack out, man.
Like
You can see mine too. It's cool.
Nah, man. You done seen an ass before.
Nah, man.
You got a point. Nah, Shakur acted real tough. He got a point.
Nah, come on.
You taking like the 9-on-1?
I can't do it.
No.
You got to beat me up and take my clothes off me, bro.
That might be worse.
You want to see me naked? You're going to have to earn it. No homo.
All these fight videos you watching on Cali Bang and just making Marie think a lot of shit. I'm just not trying.
Because people think of like the polite fights you be seeing online. That Cali Bang and subreddit, niggas be whooping shit. Like,
oh, yeah, I know. You don't have to whoop me like that then, bro. You're not going to, hey, nigga.
So you got whooped and stripped. Now what?
They earned it. It is what it is.
Hey, there is that video of the nigga getting stripped at the gas station, which was wild.
And they made him stand on the chair.
there was hella people out there. See, I might get stripped, but there's no way you're not making me clap my ass.
Bro, that nigga get naked. Where was the chair from? Why did they pull the chair out somewhere?
I think it was from like in front of the store or something like that.
They made that nigga stand on the chair.
They brought a fold out chair. Like, yeah, we were waiting for this nigga. Shake that ass.
What?
At the gas station, there's hoes out there. Oh yeah, you got to kill me before you can make me. Not even hoes
versus regular people. Everybody's at the gas station.
Some kid in the back seat's like, Mom, what's happening?
That's insane. You're trying to squeeze your window up there.
Bro, they be that nigga stand on a chair and clap his butt cheeks. I didn't rain off.
Oh, hell yeah.
You literally have to go kill everybody.
Yeah, I'm trying. Yeah, nah. Anyway.
Get me the fuck, man.
Oh, man. All right. I don't even know how we got there.
What else? Damn. You caught up on Power, Tyrell?
Yes, I am.
Jamal, yes, you're gonna catch up on Power.
No, he's two shows behind. He ain't catching up on shit.
Hey, man, talk about it. I can chime in. I know they got a shout out to Light Skin Keisha in the show.
Light Skin Beaches.
They done disrupted her whole class schedule, man. She ain't been doing nothing except contributing to conversations, and now she can't even go to class.
All of her teachers are dead.
I have to learn from Rashad Tate.
Yeah, I must say her only teacher is a nigga who's never taught anything and hasn't taught anything in the class since he's been there.
Yeah, his sole skill is political scamming.
Oh my god. Hey, it's so funny the cultural differences, and I'm sure now that I say this, Blake's gonna be like, I didn't know. Amira was looking at Laurent Tate, the brothers on the show, and she goes, mm-hmm. They look hella familiar. And I was like, they're brothers. And she goes, are you serious? I was like, yeah, I remember when I was like five.
I ain't even gonna hold you out. Like, one, I didn't know of Laurent Tate probably until this. I probably did, but I just didn't realize. Like,
I forgot about him.
What's he known for?
He was in like Scary Movie. He's in a bunch of smaller shit. But I will say, when I was a kid, I thought he was the same person. I was like, oh, this nigga's just gotten like a little fat, because he's always been like a little chunkier than him. He's in Don't Be a Menace. He's in a couple other like little random things.
I'm gonna tell you right now, Amara's not by herself. I promise you. I'm gonna ask Bree this weekend. I know she doesn't know their brothers.
Oh, and that's what I'm saying. That's the cultural difference I'm talking about. Because I feel like at some point, most black kids just find out, like, oh, yeah, these niggas is brothers. She was like, they look so similar. That's so crazy. And I was like, yes, Lorenz and Laurent Tate. She goes, and their last name is Tate?
Yeah. I feel like they got some good voices for, like, voice acting in video games. Like, I'd like to see that. I'm sure maybe they've done it before, but
I want to say, if you look up Laurent Tate, I feel like he's done video game voice acting. I feel like he's done a little bit of everything.
Yeah.
That's okay, like when you find out what's the names of brother? The Goodings?
Omar and Cuba Gooding.
Oh, I thought you said they had a sister. Never mind. You're talking about, those two, yeah.
Yeah. Nah, I didn't find that out.
On Amazon that was like, had Megan Good in it called Harlem.
Oh, yeah.
Over there?
Oh, hell no. I seen a clip of that show. That shit looks.
Nah, I made that 15 minutes. Okay, back to Power, though. So, they pulled off like the great age caper with Zeke.
I guess.
Yeah, you know.
I want to know, because what his birth? So she said that the way that it all unfolded, like Diana having the birth certificate and slapping it on the table, is fucking wild. Like, anyway, but like, so when he was two or when he was six, they were like, yeah, you're three. And he was just like, okay. Like, that kid he needs some help. Everything about, he needs some help. They took advantage of that boy, and I don't like it.
And I'm still unsure if, like, this is just how he is. Well, actually, no. I know that's how the actor is. I saw his music video now.
Yeah,
but
and
like,
you know that's Zeke's it.
Supposed to be dumb, or if, like, he's, like, just, that's just how the actor is.
Nah, I think Zeke's supposed to be dumb. And now it makes even more sense, because we have both had that question. But the fact that they convinced him, like, the grades had a matchup, right? So they obviously had to like hold him back several grades for him to be a six-year-old that they were telling was two going into first grade.
Yeah, that's what they said.
Yeah. So like if he believed he was 19 until they said he was 23. So he had to have been going to school 4 years older than all of his classmates, not realizing he was 4 years older than his classmates. That's got to have some developmental shit with it, where you're just like sitting at home until you're six. Before you go to kindergarten or whatever. Like,
you got to think about it, though. Like,
when that might be too much thinking about the show.
You control their scale of time. Like, they don't know when their birthday is until you tell them it's their birthday.
I agree. Yeah. I just.
It's possible.
At whatever age where he would have realized I'm 4 years older than everyone around me and he still didn't, like, know because no one told him. Something developmental had to happen. And like you said earlier, that's probably too much thinking for a show that's asking you not to think. But everybody's reaction was so funny.
Is like how, because like that's what Monet was saying in this last one, is that like she left him down there with her sister, So her sister had to do all like the con work, right? Or whatever.
Yeah.
And why would Zeke just come to New York to go to college? Or I think maybe he finished high school and then went to college.
That's what it sounds like. Like last couple of years of high. Cause they were like, when we figured out you could go to the league.
So how come they, why would they even do that with his age in the first place?
I don't understand. Yeah. See, the more questions, I don't understand that. And I don't like, why are you looking at this boy who, you know, you've lied about his age to everybody and be like, hey, we could get you to the NBA. You didn't think the NBA was ever going to ask to see a birth certificate. The college never asked to see a birth certificate.
I've got a couple cases. People got drafted before that came out.
Yeah, but that was like people coming from overseas and shit, not niggas coming from Harlem.
Buddy Hield, he didn't come straight from overseas. He was at Oklahoma for a year.
But yeah, he went to the, he came from the Bahamas. They doctored some shit up. It's, I feel like it's easier to do that than if like you're born in fucking Atlanta.
I don't know. They'd be over here. Taco Fall might have been over here a couple of years too. Not Taco Fall.
Bismack Biyombo.
Him too. Bismack Biyombo is definitely lying. Serge Ibaka is definitely lying.
Yeah.
Nah, Serge Ibaka was 29 or something.
Serge Ibaka said he's like 31, but he got a back of a 46-year-old.
Nah, yeah. What's the name? Is definitely lying about his age. Bismack Biyombo.
Yes, they pulled it off. But yeah, when Kane found out, he was like, "Wait, so I'm not your oldest son? Like, I don't give a fuck about none of this. I just thought I was your oldest kid." But like, so Kane being 21 is wild as fuck because that's a wild ass boy for 21.
He's activated.
Yeah, there's a lot of shit that I'm surprised they didn't put two and two together that Mecca and Dante were the same person until like yesterday.
He did a good job though, kind of. I feel like
he did. Yeah, he never told Kane his name was Dante, and no one ever like seen them.
Zeke never asked how he had so much damn money.
Yeah, Zeke don't be asking the right questions. Zeke don't be asking none of the right questions.
And then his new daddy just pulls out a pistol at the basketball part.
And his mom. Everybody ready to blick shit. Yeah, so
money to shoot. She's scary.
This show is just straight comedy. Like, you helped your mom rob me. Go rob him back. And then the kids are just robbing.
Which one?
Ghost. This is Ghost Season 2.
Just the one that focuses on Tariq, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Tariq and gang.
And who?
And gang.
Oh, okay. So I know. Well, so Tommy has one that's about to start up soon, right?
Starts on Sunday.
And then so they got Tommy, Tariq, Kanan, and what's the other one?
Kanan, which is Kanan's character. Which, okay. Yeah, I didn't even finish that one.
Rashad Tate has one coming too. Rashad Tate, Lorenz.
I'm interested to see how that's going to go. I don't know if I need that. I'm sure they'll figure out a way to make it good, but
I trust 50 at all ends now. And like, you know, he building this Powerverse thing. And I remember this topic now that we're talking about this. I'm trying to tell y'all, man, y'all got to get on the Yeehaw verse, the fucking Yellowstone 1883 verse. That shit is gas, bro. I'm telling you. Like, y'all leaving me. It's cool.
I'll start it next month. I can't do that this month.
Oh, my God. Yellowstone has a...
I don't want to watch black people in 1883, bro.
Hey, can I talk to you about that?
You go ahead. Because I won't watch it until March. I'll definitely forget.
Okay, so the first thing I was saying, Yellowstone has like three black people, but it's like the middle of nowhere, ranchland in Montana. It's probably accurate. 1883. So it starts out like in Fort Worth, Texas. And like that's what I was telling you about the goddamn, that the agency that's in Red Dead, that's the real thing. What are they called?
The Pinkertons?
Pinkertons, yeah. Because the Pinkertons are one of the first like places to actively hire like women and black people. It helped with like them blending in places and people not suspecting things of them and all that stuff. So one of the main characters is this black dude who worked for the Pinkertons, and it deals with like not only like, I guess, like the racism part of like being a black man in Texas in 1883, which was like the last state to abolish slavery, but just like the kind of things that like he kind of deals with, like how he deals with the world, because they're trying to move this caravan of like immigrants from Europe from Texas all the way to Oregon is the plan. That's how things are going right now. And this lady, her husband dies on the thing, and she ends up falling for the black dude. And he's like just hella hesitant to do anything with her, to have a relationship with her. He's like, yo, people will kill us both if we do anything together. So it's like, I can't do anything with you. And, but he still like cares about her. So like, he's like still trying to do shit in a way that's like not like overtly romantic or anything like that. But it's just like kind of that dynamic of like, you kind of have to like put your feelings on the back burner for you, like everyone's personal safety and shit.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I think it's a good show. Okay. Man. They
not,
it's not like glorifying that time or anything like that. Like they talk about like the things with the Native Americans and shit like that too. Like in, Yellowstone's very big on that as well. They're both really good shows. They're just like kind of slice of life shows.
Are they in the same universe for real though?
Yes. So the way they're connected is that Yellowstone is about the Yellowstone Dutton Ranch, and John Dutton's the main character of Yellowstone. John Dutton's, I think, grandfather is a child on 1883.
Got it. Okay.
He's in the caravan. He's like, he's the kid of like one of the main male protagonists.
Got it. So they're not really connected necessarily, but they're literally in the same universe.
It is. It's connected because this is about how they got the Yellowstone, how they got
their
ranch. Okay. So like right now they're trying to get to Oregon, but something's probably going to happen that makes them end up in Montana.
Got it.
And it's about how they ended up with that land in the first place.
Yeah, I keep seeing the previews for it on Paramount Plus. It looks decent. I just haven't even considered it.
Very good actors in both too. Kevin Costner's on Yellowstone, and then all the supporting cast is like phenomenal. And then on this, Sam Elliott is the main character on 1883, and he's really good as well.
How many seasons in are these shows?
What do you say?
How many seasons in are they?
Yellowstone just finished season 4. 1883 is in its first season right now.
Oh, okay.
And then it'll be Yellowstone's only like 10 episode seasons, but they're each like an hour, and they're heavy hitting ass episodes, dog. Like if you like Sons of Anarchy, just like how they handled like pacing with like action and conversational like combatantness and all that shit and like stuff like that, I think it's easy to get into Yellowstone because they and like then that. Yeah,
they got shows all like shit. Shows like Sons of Anarchy, now that you mentioned, or even I'll always go back to, but The Wire, really make me appreciate how they can handle pacing, because I feel like Power, the pacing is have a conversation, somebody calls, gotta go. Have a conversation, shoot somebody calls, gotta go. Like every single scene starts or ends with a phone call, which is so fucking annoying to me.
I feel like I'd have a hard time selling anybody on Power, even though I love that show to death, just because like its flaws are like so in your face.
Yeah. I think part of it is like you just gotta not, like you gotta watch, because the first couple seasons like I didn't feel like had a lot of that. So once you get into it, and then you're into the show, it's like, okay, this is really good. The further along they get, the more it's like, what?
And more ridiculous it got. That's what I started.
When Ghost and Tommy and Kanan just walk around like dropping 30 bodies an episode and shit. Like,
Hey, I'm going to go clean. Okay, I got to kill 3 people, including an FBI agent, and then I'm done. Like, what? That's not how any of this works.
And he just, all Ghost does is put on the same goddamn black hoodie.
like
I'm about to go kill somebody. I got my murder hoodie on.
He sprints to every murder too. He doesn't drive. He runs to every murder because he's in good shape. He's got to remind you he's got a 6-pack.
I'm about to cancel Christmas on his ass.
Oh, that's a great line.
Yep. All right. Y'all want to get to the meat and potatoes?
Let's get to the potatoes. I got some dossiers. Let's get it.
Oh, we got documents planned up. All right. So for people who've been living under a rock, Brian Flores was fired from the Dolphins 2 weeks ago.
About 2 weeks ago.
About as controversial a coaching move has been made as this offseason. I think most of the conversation you'll see about it was that the firing was unjust. And from there, I think it was kind of a quiet 2 weeks until this last week. And then
it was a hella quiet 2 weeks. We didn't hear no coach talk.
They tried to run the little, they was talking about the 2-4 situation. Like, cause they let some stuff come out, but then like in that, some of those documents showed that part wasn't true. How they said, he was just like, super wilding on Tua, saying they should have drafted
him. Come out the day he got fired. It was like, he was going around asking people, like, kind of asking other teammates to shit on Tua, and he clearly didn't like him. It was shitting on Tua to other people. I do remember that.
But then, like that lawsuit, there was something about how he didn't want Deshaun Watson because, like, something about like the locker room or
like, if they made it seem like
stuff about character and on his teams, and then how would he look if they wanted they brought Deshaun Watson in and all the stuff that's going on with him.
Yeah. Okay. So they have the rumors leaked to the media. Other than that, I don't think there was much directly from Brian Flores for that span until this past week where this lawsuit comes out. It's a class action lawsuit. Brian Flores like basically versus the NFL. Tim, and I think there's other black head coaches that have signed on to the lawsuit. Is correct?
I don't know if they've said who. They said other people are being represented. They haven't said who. I know Hugh Jackson's the only one that's like publicly come out and said that he's in support.
Okay. So basically, though, the thing about this lawsuit is that it's talking about how he was put in a situation to fail, and then I think the hiring process as well, with people trying to bring him in for interviews that they already selected their candidates. One of the main highlights being the 100K per loss thing that he alleges was offered to him from Stephen Ross.
Stephen Ross offered him 100K per loss that first two seasons.
Yeah,
And then he said that when he interviewed for the for the Broncos job, and John Elway and the staff showed up hungover, smelling like liquor. And then I guess it turned out that they went out celebrating with Vic Fangio the night before because they determined they were going to hire him, but they had to still.
His first go around for hiring.
Yeah, that was from his first go around, and then the Giants thing was from this go around.
Okay, I got confused. I thought he that happened when he's dealing with Elway this time. I was like, did they even hire anybody yet? Like, they did get someone now, but
they got Nathaniel Hackett.
Yeah, I don't think you're getting tore up on Nathaniel Hackett, but maybe
he got Vic Fangio. I was like, my guy, let's get it.
Oh, we're fucking back.
But so a bunch of sleazy shit.
Yeah, and it's basically driven the conversation when it comes to probably football this week, at least probably if not sports, just. Because the NFL, like we talked about last week, has a very large discrepancy with black coaches in their coaching base, and that's like not just head coaches, coordinators as well, front office, like basically anything that's not on the wearing a helmet. Black people are like heavily underrepresented, and like it's at a point where I think it's impossible to not address it. So this is like an attempt to maybe like at least put light on it, because I don't know what the end outcome of it could be, if not just that.
Yeah, I don't know what the outcome is going to be either, because I feel like the NFL is in such a position that they can't really be pressured to do anything they don't want. Like, none of these owners really give a fuck about public perception. Like, Dan Snyder's going through all this like nasty shit, fumbles every like PR opportunity he gets, and it's like, some fans kind of tune out, like, whatever, but, like, nobody really gives a fuck. And it seems like anytime, like, the discourse, especially online, but a lot of the discourse you see is, like, oh, I don't believe Brian Flores or anything that people put out. I'm going to believe that over that. Like, the Giants have put their statement out, which is basically just like, nah, we didn't do it. Here's our itinerary for him. Doesn't add up. The Giant or the NFL, like, an hour later was like, none of this is true. So once people see that, they're like, yeah, it's not true. They said they looked into it. It wasn't true. So I don't know. Like, I don't think they're going to get enough public pressure that's actually going to do anything to make them start hiring black people. Because it's not like we just brought the shit up.
What? So you better say something, Jamal. I want to cut you off.
Oh, no. I won't say no.
Okay. With what you said, though, like, what could they possibly do? Because at the end of the day, these are private companies. And it's like they have the right to hire who they want to hire. So, like, what could they do?
That's the thing. I don't think anybody knows, honestly.
I think the same thing that it would take for I think it's impossible for the oppressed to like make the situation change. So I don't think if black coaches are like, hey, we're not coaching anymore until you hire more of us, that's not going to work. Maybe if like every white coach was like, not working until you start hiring more black people, but I don't see that happening. If players start striking, like I think it would take a mass movement of not just like the seven black coaches we got being like not employed, because there's only one black coach employed, but it would have to be like every black coach that's a candidate working together. But I don't think that would even work. I think it's going to take a much bigger movement that
players are going to be involved, I think.
Yeah. Like, and I don't think that's going to happen. Like, I don't think there's a world where that issue happens. Maybe Jay-Z can get it done. I don't know.
So I brought this up last week with Jamal that like, largely I feel like, because for the majority of people, coaching starts from the bottom up, right? Like you work your way up from somewhere, whether that be like a
quality control
assistant in college at some place, and then you just keep going up from there. Or yeah, whatever that may be. But like largely, like, cause just knowing what I know two people who are coaches, that's not a job that they necessarily can do and live off of. Like they'll both have other jobs that they do, and coaching is just something that they dedicate their time to during football season.
Yep.
And
even starting now, there's no guarantee you're working your way up. Like you might be a GC making $12K a year for 8 years before you even get a bump up from there, let alone head coach.
Yeah. So it's like if I guess the point I was trying to make last week was that like people who have income in a way that they may be able to not worry so much about their day job and focus more time on that thing.
Yep.
Dedicated to football, maybe like end up at a graduate assistant and whatever and go from there. Like those people who are their lives have them in those spots tend to not be black most of the time. Like just cause like our socioeconomic situation in this country due to years and years of systemic and institutional racism. Yeah. Like it's
to say that it seems like we have a pool of guys like we say the league is 70% black. There's obviously black players in the league who want to be coaches. You get
players. That's different though.
Sure. It's kind of different. A lot of NFL head coaches played in some form or fashion, but a lot of those guys do want to get be coaches and don't get the fair shake or don't get a shake at all. Or at best can be an assistant defensive coordinator.
So we hear all the time about like in college, like with recruiting and stuff like that. Guys who end up at places like Michigan, Northwestern, Notre Dame, who wouldn't be there if it wasn't for football, right? And those people can't necessarily stay there as a graduate assistant because a graduate assistant has to be able to maintain their grades and stay in school. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. You're not going to get the football classes anymore. Like you have to take actual Notre Dame classes now, right?
Yes, but I also think if coaches want that to happen, they can make it happen. And I find it hard to believe that that wouldn't be the case. Like, not necessarily a graduate assistant, but for example, and this is somebody who probably does do this, but if Nick Saban or Dabo Sweeney. What'd you say?
Because, so there's that. And then there's people who are just at the school as well, who like have in their mind that they're going to have a career in football. Like there's not that many of us who are in a spot to do that as well. And it's like,
sure.
Those issues are, I guess, like I'm saying, like these issues start like way before the NFL. It's like,
that's true.
Yeah. Like, I don't know. Like I know the focus is going to be on the league with like all of this, but it's like, dog, like these issues are like way bigger than the league. This is just like an after effect of something much larger.
Yeah. No,
I'm looking at it like that at first, but no, that definitely makes sense.
I definitely agree. I pulled up a list of coaches who kind of like, just got their shoe in off of who you know, which that's a lot of industries. So it's not like
nepotism is huge.
Like, and it's that's the frustrating part. But yeah, like every industry, there's some nepotism there. But it's like nepotism
though. Everyone wants to be able to do that for their family. Like, everybody
for
wants
sure. That shit. Yeah, for sure.
And their friends.
Yeah, it's just frustrating because it's like I guess if the excuse is always going to be they're like we're not going to hire you because you can't afford to be a QC for 7 years before you can move up. We're just never going to hire you. So I guess, yeah, again, it's never going
to
change.
We're not going to know you in the first place to hire you is the problem. Yeah. Like,
so I was looking through some like coaches who have recently been hired. And this is also what I guess I using this to like make a point, but I don't want the argument to be like who's more qualified or who's less qualified. Because some of these guys are good. Some of these guys are bad, but it's just the way you get yourself in the door. So the first one I pulled up was Arthur Smith. Cause I know he is like a huge benefactor of nepotism. So Arthur Smith, the coach of the Falcons, his dad is the founder of FedEx.
FedEx, right? Yeah.
Yeah. So every position he had before he worked for the Falcons was in some way like funded by FedEx. So he went to North Carolina, graduated, became a grad assistant. North Carolina has a FedEx global student union or something like that building on campus. He went to Washington with a defensive quality right after being a grad assistant for a year. Goes to Washington. He's a defensive QC there. Washington, FedEx Field, obviously. Goes to Ole Miss, where his dad has a building named after him. Then goes to Tennessee, also a FedEx Stadium. And then, like, kind of from there, you work your way up. He was there from 2011 to 2020 and then became a head coach. But, like, quality control, tight ends coach, offensive coordinator. Like, that's a hell of a leap. He may have been qualified for that, but it's like, yeah, we never have the shot to, like, make it in there. And that's the same thing with, like, Zach Taylor, who's in the Super Bowl, maybe a good coach, maybe not. Married Pat Sherman's daughter out of college, and Pat Sherman gave him a job in the NFL. You take off from there. Like, you just got your foot in the door because you married the right coach's son and kind of take off from there. So it's like, if we can't ever get into the position to even have those, I guess there is no, like, real way to change it, but it doesn't seem fair. And when the NFL's talking about, for the last 2 years, making things equal and equality and you are one of the biggest companies on the face of the earth. You can find a way to make a pipeline if you want to. You just are choosing not to.
Yeah, they would need to invest at the bottom level to get people opportunities to coach at the bottom level.
Exactly.
Like, run the camps and all that shit all the way up.
And it might not even be the NFL, because I was listening to a pod today where they kind of made the point of, like, a lot of the actual NFL's, like, their, like, upper management are people of color or just women or minorities or whatever. It's the owners, and the owners are choosing not to do that. But all 32 cities, you got 50 million little league coaches in every fucking city and state that you're in. You could make a pipeline.
Yeah, if how you do we get them in the clinics to help them gain these skills to get the job at the next level and move on from that? And at the same time, it's like the point Hugh Jackson brought up when he was talking on the Pivot podcast was that, like, not that I'm not comparing little league to HBCU football, but it's like, people who may be coaching HBCU aren't thinking about coaching in the NFL just because they love what they do so much at HBCU, like what they mean to that community, what they mean to that college, that campus, and everything like that. It's like, this is what they want to do. And it's like, a little league coach might feel that same way about the kids that he's taking care of and, like, molding and shit like that. So it's like,
not everybody wants to be a head coach with something he said.
At least, like, make sure that, or not make sure, but, like, if the opportunities are there and people are choosing not to take them, that's fine. But if the opportunity's, like, if you're not trying to get new minds involved,
you won't.
Because at the end of the day, I mean, like, whether you're getting a bunch of 7-year-olds to rally behind you, or it's, like, high schoolers, or it's college kids, or it's pro football people, like, that takes a certain type of person to do it. And it's like, you never know what you could make or what the potential for a coach could be until you start trying all these avenues. Like, you have to put people in the fire, give them the chance, man. Like,
I think that's a great point. Cause, like, how we're talking about, you got to start from the bottom. So, like, okay, most of these guys that are on this list go from grad assistant to some sort of something else. And then they work their way up from there.
Yeah. Quarterbacks.
You should have, like, if the league is putting together some sort of coaching clinic where it's like, hey, every year, and it don't gotta just be black folks. Like, that doesn't have to just be that. You can put an emphasis on it, but it's like, hey, the 5,000 coaches every year get to come to Indy and do this coaching clinic. And hey, we see this guy, we can make you the fucking assistant audio tape guy or whatever. And then you can work your way from there. But
let's get you in the room, let's get you a badge. Let you sit at the table.
Like, because you can't tell me, like, Joe Judge, who, like, you get your first head coaching job and within 3 years you look inept. Within 2 years, you look like you shouldn't be in that position at all. There's got to be a million black Joe Judges out there who can be a special teams assistant for 6 years and then be a head coach somewhere, but you're just not looking for those people. So it's not that you can't, like, some coaches keep, Bruce Arians keeps finding black coaches that are
terrible. Like, honestly, like, just, like, based on the numbers, like, the splits between us and them in those positions, like we were saying, like, what it takes to be able to have these, like, non-paying jobs for that long. Like,
sure. No, yeah, no, that,
we
that
part usually can't afford to take those chances.
The NFL doesn't have to make them non-paying jobs either, though. That's a much different conversation.
I'm talking about, like, to get to the point where you have the NFL special teams coach job. Like,
sure.
To be able to take those chances, like, there's not that many of us that can do that.
Oh, that's no, and that's where I'm saying, like, the clinics that they could do, which is impacting more. Like, they have these, like, community outreach things that they're pushing now over the last couple of years, and that could be one of them where it's like, we're not just like, oh, we're going to give you some money to, like, go to a better high school or whatever. Like, we're putting you in a position to get a job with the league, and it doesn't have to just be playing the game. If you have a coaching clinic where 5,000 people come each day, hey, you got some great ideas, or you're good, we're going to bring you in as just a QA guy or QC guy. We're not going to pay you $12,000 because we can afford to pay you 50, 60, whatever, like, something. Motherfuckers are living off way less than that everywhere. And the league makes more than enough money to be able to do that and sustain. And you're going to have way less of these dumbass controversies every single coaching cycle pretty much of my life. We've talked about, oh, wow, there's one black coach. Oh, we got six. Okay, now there's one. Now we got three. Now we got – you could completely two. Eliminate that. You're cutting people off from wanting to watch your game strictly because, like, oh, we can't find the black talent because you can't afford to do an unpaid internship for 6 years before we start, like, actually giving you a shot. There are definitely avenues. It's just a matter of how much do you want those avenues to be a thing.
Yeah.
They got to want to change something, man. They gotta want to do it, honestly, right?
Yeah.
And you know, and owners, like, they hire, like, who they feel comfortable with. And, you know, most of the time, I'm for sure, like, these old white guys that own these teams, they feel more comfortable with these, like white candidates that they bring in for, like, interviews and stuff. But
for sure.
They got to – it makes the league look a certain way. Like, it's getting bad.
Do y'all put any type of, like, blame or – how do you feel about, like, I guess, like, black head coaches who don't take on black staffs, though? Like, if we don't have, like, black coordinators or at all, like
– like, if a black head coach doesn't have any, like, black people on the staff? Well, nigga, there's only one.
Not on the staff, but I mean, like, if you know, like, a coordinator is probably, like, the most guaranteed role to get you the next job, right?
Yeah, like, so usually, like, offensive coordinators use offensive, like, defensive coordinators. Yeah, what about it?
So, if you're saying, like, if these opportunities are scarce, like, do y'all feel this type of way about, like, if a black head coach doesn't have a black coordinator? Like, is that, like, a failure on his part?
Yes and no.
But there's only, like, one, though. Like, niggas.
And that was the point Hugh Jackson.
No, Mike Tomlin is the only black head coach
right now. Yeah. Right now.
So part of me feels like I don't want to fault you for, like, not immediately bringing everybody with you when you don't really feel like you got your foot all the way in the door. Like, I can speak for somebody who's, like, giving references at a job. Like, I don't want to give my homie a reference before I'm good here, just in case you do fuck up. So it's like, hey, I'm Vance Joseph. I might have 3 years. I might have one. Do I want to bring in this all black?
Like, you're saying, like, there's not a qualified one you feel confident
no,
in?
No, I'm saying reach back by literally reaching back and bringing a nigga with you. Like,
no, but if you feel like that's the best person for the job, then, like, why would it have to be that?
I mean, I guess maybe I'm not wording it right. I'm not saying it's a reach as far as, like, they're not qualified. I'm talking about giving them the opportunity that they're not getting. Because clearly they're not getting those opportunities elsewhere because they're not getting hired elsewhere. So I'm saying,
I know, like, but I'm
bringing you with me.
Hired. We're saying, like, they're just not getting hired. So if, like, you feel like this person's, like, the best person for the job, then it's, like, shouldn't be a reach to have them on the staff, right?
Sure. Yeah. And it may not be a reach for me to have them on the staff. But if I'm Vance Joseph and I have a black offensive coordinator, black defensive coordinator, and we win 4 games, they're going to be like, this ain't working. Y'all need to figure this out, or y'all all out of here, or it's just y'all all out of here. And I can easily see people thinking that way. Because for sure. if owners but and
it wasn't
you're,
working,
you're being hella optimistic about it, though. Like, if owners are already saying, like, hey, we're only hiring a handful of black people ever. I think there's been 20. Hugh said there's been 20 black coaches ever. So they only think there's 20 of us qualified enough to be at that level. And if it's like, hey, you made a bad decision by hiring somebody I already didn't think was qualified enough, that's putting a stain that I feel like is an unnecessary stain. Whether that be the truth or not, we know that's how it's going to be perceived, because when black head coaches get fired, you ain't getting a second job more times than not. Black coordinators get fired, you probably ain't getting another job more times than not.
I can't, dog, because that sounds crazy, dog, because that's like, I'm not hiring black people to save black people.
It sounds insane to us because you're black and using logic. You're not using the logic of the white dude who's like, I don't already want you niggas here.
I'm not talking about the white guy, though. I'm talking about the coaches who don't give those opportunities to black coordinators. Like,
And hey, the maybe they don't think that a nigga's the most qualified person. Like, maybe they don't think the black OC that they interview was the most qualified person, or the black defensive coordinator. Like, I don't know. But I'm not going to say I feel a type of way, because I can see the things that you might be thinking through as to why you didn't do that. If we're being realistic, if we're being idealist and like, hey, yeah, like, I think you're the best person for the job. Like, black people are probably the best person for the job all the time in the NFL, and they're clearly not getting the jobs. So I'm putting the onus on the one black dude that gets hired. Oh, you got to make sure you go get Pep Hamilton, and make sure you go get Frosty Whitaker, because you know they're great OCs and DCs. But if it don't work out, niggas working again.
if there's only one black head coach and we're saying all these people are getting passed over for jobs, then that means there's absolutely someone who's right for that coordinator position that you're not picking if they're not getting hired for the other jobs.
Sure. Yeah, sure.
Why? To save them? That's insane.
So ideally, Mike Tomlin, you think, should just have like a black ass staff altogether because Marvin they're clearly Lewis, black. I'm asking you about Mike Tomlin. You think Mike Tomlin's entire Mike staff Zimmer should just be black and white?
A coordinator for a minute too, though.
No, I think if the person exists and they're right for the job, then I don't see why he shouldn't do it. Like, he's gone through three offensive coordinators and two defensive coordinators since he's been there. They've all been like old white dudes. Like, if we're saying like this is an issue and these coaches exist, the talent exists out there, like, how does it not end up on his staff? I'm not like faulting Mike Tomlin. He's a great dude, but it's like at the same time, it's like that seems like an easy win for everybody. If the people we feel like are getting shorted for jobs because they're talented enough to have the jobs are just sitting there, like, that's a free bonus to you. Like, you have a head coach quality person as your coordinator, and they also happen to be black. Like, you double down on the dubs. Like,
I agree that that's the way it should work. And I also see that there's reasons why it doesn't.
Nah, man. I think, like, yeah.
So why do you think it's not happening? Why do you think it's not happening if that's the case? Just because he doesn't want to? He don't like niggas?
No, I mean, honestly, I think whatever he's going through when he's doing his planning for what he wants the office to be, what he wants the staff to be, what he wants the team to look like, it just happens to fit a person, and that person may not be black every time. And it's like, it's probably not, it's not most of the time basically for him. So it's like the blackness doesn't matter because he's trying to win football games. You get what I'm saying? So
yeah.
If
you think he's just not even thinking about it that way.
Yeah. 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 He's okay. Trying to win. He's trying to build the best system possible.
Okay.
Who was that black coach he had on his sideline that one time when he tripped somebody and the nigga still makes
him look just like him? Joey Porter. Yeah. He was a defensive assistant in the outside. Not Joey
Porter, but there was a coach on his staff that looked just like him. Remember those pictures?
It was Joey Porter.
That's not Joey Porter in that picture.
Oh, maybe not. I don't know.
I know what you're talking about. I know what you're talking about. They were standing right next to him with the headset on too, weren't they? Yeah.
That's insane. I don't know. But and like, I don't necessarily even disagree with you, Blake. Like, obviously, if Bruce Arians can somehow find a black offensive coordinator, black defensive coordinator, black assistant,
and win a bowl?
Yeah. Like, it's obviously possible. I wish that Mike Tomlin would do that. I wish more coaches would do that. Sean McVay does it enough. Kyle Shanahan does it enough. It does also seem like
that Bruce Arians saw the system that Byron Leftwich had going for Josh Rosen and said, I need that fucking guy.
Maybe. So
I'm going to give you a shot because I believe in you.
Yeah, maybe Mike Tomlin feels like he's not in a position. And I would disagree. We don't know him. I can't speak for him. Yeah, but like, that could be one of the things where he's like, I can't just be bringing you niggas in. I can recommend you for a job, but I can't hire you here. That could be something he's thinking. I don't know. There's not a great reason why, like, if you give a nigga a shot, but yeah, like, I don't know.
Yeah, let me get Matt fucking Canada.
Shit. We fired Anthony Lynn, and Brandon Staley immediately brought in like five black assistant coaches. So like, it can be done if you want it to be done. One of them got fired immediately because he fucking stunk.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, and maybe these guys, maybe, yeah, like, I think there's a larger issue there. Like you said, Mike Tomlin's thinking of, like, what's the best way for me to win football? These white guys might be thinking, like, I don't even got to worry about the color thing. Mike Tomlin might be like, I don't want it to be a bunch of niggas in here and something go wrong and they blame all of us. Because we know niggas in position. We know black people that think that way. So it wouldn't shock me if Mike Tomlin thinks that way.
Yeah, it wouldn't be too great.
We know black hiring managers. Well, I won't say we know black hiring managers. I've spoken to black people who are in positions to hire people, and it's like, I'm holding you to a different standard because you're black. So you need to be better than you even are now, even though you're the most qualified person for the position. But you need to be better because you look like me. So I wouldn't be surprised if that's the same way that Mike Tomlin feels. And Brandon Staley's not hiring a black dude thinking like, you need to be twice as good as you actually are. He's just like, oh, you're a good special teams assistant or whatever. I'm going to hire you. I don't give a fuck about none of the other shit. Bruce Arians might not care about like, oh yeah, you kind of sucked in Arizona. I'm going to give you a shot because ain't nobody going to question me. Like, I feel like we have enough real world applications to put into the NFL where we know that these things happen at fucking Best Buy that we can apply to these people who are very likely thinking in similar ways.
I'm not shooting him no fucking bail on that until he does it, though. Like, honestly, like, that's, that shit's absurd. Like,
I'm not shooting him any bail. I'm just telling you why I think this is happening. Yeah. Should he be hiring more black coaches? You've had the job for 15 years. You have enough leeway. You can hire whoever you want.
He came in with Dick LeBeau as his DC, which I don't fault you for like, keeping him. Like, that's a fucking legend. Sure. Like, you don't just get rid of Dick LeBeau. But like, his offensive coordinator has just been like Todd Haley and Matt Canada. One other guy, I think.
He had, like, Todd Haley, who hated fucking Ben Roethlisberger, and Ben Roethlisberger wanted to punch him in the mouth every day. And he was like,
hey, Ben Roethlisberger threw 5,200 yards under Todd Haley, too.
Yeah, insane. Like, yeah. No, I'm not shooting him any bail. Do I think, or I will say, do I wish he did hire more black coaches, especially at the position he's in now? Absolutely. Especially when we go through these, like, periods where it's like, you're literally the only one, and you're watching everybody else get passed over. I'd love to see him bring somebody else in.
You deserve to be selfish to the rest of the league is like being exclusionary. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not asking him to do that either. I just think it's increasingly weird. I don't know if Mike Tomlin has spoken up much about this. I'm not saying that he hasn't. I can't recall anything off the top of my head about him speaking on these issues in general. If he has said something about it and this is still how he's choosing to move, I'm questioning you, bro. And if you haven't said anything about it, makes sense. Like, honestly, like, I don't know. Fuck with you, though. I absolutely do. But that shit's weird.
Yeah, Mike Tomlin looking a little funny in the light now.
It's just kind of weird. That's all I'm saying.
Wasn't he the first coach that was brought in under the Rooney Rule?
He got interviewed for, like, off the Rooney Rule. I know that. I don't know if it was made because of him, but he got interviewed because of it. And he stole the show with the interview.
Yeah, no, I don't know. Yeah, the point's valid. Like, these guys, and I don't want you to fire somebody just to hire somebody else. But yeah, like these years where it's like, me and Jamal both were adamant that like Brian Flores might not have been the best coach, but he for sure got fired a year too early. Hey, cool, you gonna come on my staff? You'll be the, like Nick Saban does or like Bill Belichick does. Every time somebody get fired from Bill Belichick's staff, he's like, oh, you got a spot right back at home. Brings him back home, coaches him up for a few years.
You might not have your old job, but I mean, you can come over here. We got something. You want to do linebackers? I can get you in linebackers.
Yeah, that for sure.
I lean up in the booth for Saban, like you said. Yeah.
Yeah, you look at them Alabama and them fucking New England coaching staffs, you see left for a year. Okay, never mind. I'm back. Left for a year. Josh McDaniel, keep leaving and coming back. He'll be back there in 4 years, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. He's the Raiders coach now, right?
For now.
Yeah, that was kind of quiet, I feel like.
It was kind of quiet.
Because the last time they hyped him up, the nigga left. He got that indie job, and they were like, he was like,
you talking about like places with established quarterbacks that be open? That's probably one of the rare ones.
That's very true.
That team is like, ready to go. That's a playoff team.
Yeah, they won, 10 games last year on a year where, realistically, I took them winning 5 games. Like, they shouldn't have been as good as they were. Yeah. If you're worth being a head coach there, you should be able to win 9-10 games with that team next year. I don't think they will, but they should be.
If Josh McDaniels is worse than they were this year, because they went through hell this year. So there's
fire
no
him after a year. Fire. And that, you know, the players are going to be like, we had Rick Bisaccia and he was better than you. And now he's gone. We hate you. Because all them players was crying when that brother left.
I feel like they got to get like 12 wins to make that higher rate.
Yeah. Do you think, like, I was thinking about that earlier, too, when I was thinking about, like, how black coaches get fired and when or when. And I don't always feel like the firing is improper. I do think the hirings don't work out. Do you think if a coach, like, let's say you inherit a 10-win team and you win 6 the next year with essentially the same team, you think you should be fired after a year, or you should keep like getting to shake shit out a little bit more?
Unless like the players are like shitting on you and like you're running the team bad and like your staff is, there's just like shit is like going really bad. I can see that. Yeah. But like, you know, like football's like, anything can happen on any Sunday. Like, you got to go into injuries, like, stuff like that, go into account for it, too. So, it all just depends. But I think you should at least get, like, 2 to 3 years.
I agree.
I think, if it's a perfect clean slate and everything's fine, then probably no, you shouldn't be. That's probably just give it one more year. If you start out slow, then get them out of here. But realistically, it's like, I forgot who said this quote. They said, like, every single year, there's probably like seven teams in the NFL trying to win. Other than that, like the other teams really aren't. So, and then with that, the teams that keep on going through coaches, it's like the same pool of like 10.
Yeah.
They just get recycled.
When they get like one little taste of success, like whether it be the with the Todd Bowles like 10 win season out the gate in New England or on the Jets,
New York.
There was someone else we brought up too. Like I think Leslie Frazier, he started out with like a 10 win season on the Vikings and then it fell apart. Yeah. Those teams, they feel like, yo, you're wasting our roster that miraculously got to this one point this one year. And we feel like we can instantly make things better. It's like probably why Jim Caldwell got let go too, because it's like, well, how come we're not winning at all? We got kicked out of the playoffs. Like, we couldn't do more than this. And it's like you motherfucker, you don't realize, like, this is me. I'm the system here. I am the culture. I am the franchise. You're going to get rid of me, and all that's going to be left is the shitty Detroit Lions culture. And that's it. And that's worth four wins. Tops.
You mentioning that really makes me more frustrated that black coaches don't get more shakes, because they, like, there usually is like seven open positions almost every single season. Like five to seven head coaching jobs open every single year, which means usually the offensive and defensive coordinators are going with them. And we get like, I remember the one year where it was seven black coaches in the league, and I was like, oh my fucking God, like shit's really about to change. And within 4 years, all of them niggas were fired.
Yep.
Like, God, man.
A point Hugh Jackson brought up on the interview too is like, the scarcity of opportunities that you have basically means that like you're going to say yes to what comes to you, because like there's only 32 NFL coaching jobs, and then you don't really have any leverage to negotiate anything beyond that, right? So it's like you got the job and you're in there, and like maybe you and the GM aren't exactly on the same page, and like maybe the GM and the owner want to do more stuff with the draft and like roster control than like you might like, and you can't really go anywhere from there. And not saying that's what happened to Hugh Jackson, because that I think the Browns went like 5-1 and, or 5-3-1 or something like that.
I think when they cut him in the middle of the year,
they got instantly better once they got rid of him.
They were immediately better. So, yeah,
I don't think this will happen with him, but I'm like, that is like, that's legit a thing where it's like you, there's not that many jobs available, so it's not like if one of us like just going to apply for a job. And you get the chance to negotiate because you can go work somewhere else if you don't like this place. Like, that's not the thing with the NFL. So it's like,
them opportunities is limited, man.
You kind of got to roll with whatever's there. And like, you saw Byron like do the smart thing and not step into a role where he was in a place where he didn't feel comfortable. Like, he didn't want Balky there.
He didn't want to work with Balky,
Adrian Wilson in, because that's someone he felt comfortable with. And it's like, a lot of people aren't bold enough to do that in the first place. Like, but you probably should, because I mean, you're gonna maybe ruin the one opportunity you get if you don't. Like,
God, I think you'll get a chance someday. Oh,
absolutely.
I think that how that situation played out and how inept the Jags owner seems will be the reason he does. Like, I don't know if every coach in every situation could do that. Like, I'm demanding you bring my GM in or I'm not coming, and get away with it. But like, the Jags just look like such a shit show this offseason that everybody's got to be like, we're not even like,
and it's rare that like a new first time head coach, like, you can't just like, you know, like, you'd be like, oh, I want this guy as my GM. Cause they were saying like, cause they were talking about bringing in the old Vikings GM. What's his name? Spielman. But his main thing was that he just didn't want to work with Balky. But there's like, even like Daniel Jeremiah said it on Move the Sticks. Like, Tyra, I know you listen to Move the Sticks sometimes. Like, he said he knew people that like were up for like coaching jobs. They're not taking that interview. And he
not
said,
calling the,
and
not
I'll leave the it phone. At that just because of that. But
they said that Trent Baalke has fired four coaches in his last four seasons or something like that. Like, not even just with the Jags, but when he was with San Francisco and immediately came over and started firing more people. Like, I just don't feel like that's a person.
Yeah, like they say, he likes throwing people under the bus. He just has like a bad rep, and people like just weren't.
And the fact that he still has a job is why I side eye every owner that's like, we couldn't find the most qualified candidate, because you guys give jobs and leave jobs to these people who are super fucking inept all the time.
Because like, the thing with ownership, like, you don't need to be a fan. Like, the NFL is a money printer. It's like Chad Khan.
Sure.
Like, no, yeah,
might
yeah.
not right. give a damn about the Jaguars, but this is pretty money for
them. But you know what would print more money?
They say he bought the team for like 700 and something million, And now it's worth like over like $2 billion or $1 billion
off of you losing all the time.
What is games. More money in that? Like Tyrell, the only way that like you can realistically think about more money in that sense, if you like putting out a Super Bowl winner every single year and you're the hottest brand of football, which the Jaguars are never going to be. No offense, Jamal, but like that's not the cards for y'all. So it's like if I turn my $700 million to $2 billion in 9 years, like I'm not thinking about more money. Just keep this shit going the way it's going. Like that's hella money.
Yeah, no.
But like, it's not like I'm saying like, hey, hire more people, pay people more. Just like, get rid of the shit eggs you got. Like it, you're like a laughing stock. People are, your fans are showing up to games in clown suits. Which sure, you're making money. You don't care about all that, but you can have all the money. You can have all that money and not have the bad reputation. Like, why would you? What billionaire is like, man? I fucking love being I love going to the owners' meeting,
rubbing elbows with NFL fans.
No, but I think he's rubbing elbows with NFL owners and being like, man, my team fucking sucks, but you know, I don't give up.
He ain't doing that shit either.
They probably love him because they're like, oh, well, we know when we play his team, that's a get right game for us. Or
I bet he's been in Jacksonville like probably less than 15 times in the year since he's in the team.
I don't think that no part of me thinks that billionaires enjoy being the worst in their at anything ever. I have seen his boat, but I still don't think he don't want the smallest. Jeff Bezos built a new boat and he's probably like, hey, I need to add on to this boat. I can't believe he got a business that's just failing and he's like, oh, fuck.
I guarantee you Jeff Bezos ain't talking to him about the Jaguars.
Jeff Bezos want to buy an NFL team. He probably want to buy the NFL, actually. Anyway, it just doesn't make any sense to me. Like these billionaires be so crude and want to win and want to be the best and beat everybody. Like Jerry Jones does. I think he'd be making the wrong moves, but that motherfucker want to win and be the best so bad that he'll do and difference. Pay who and whatever. He's a football guy. I understand.
He's the old money owner. That's the difference. That's what it used to be. But now these new money guys come in because it's a great business opportunity. They don't need to care about it the way Jerry Jones does. They don't need to care about it the way the Buss family does. Like, you don't have to be that anymore. You can be like Joe Tsai for the Nets. Like it's or Mikhail Prokhorov for the Nets. Like this shit literally prints money just owning it. And then you get rid of it and like 15 years and you've quadrupled your money. Like you don't have to do anything.
It's not like it takes maximum appoint somebody else to fire Balky. Like I don't think it takes maximum effort to be like, hey, we can change this, right? Like I can get rid of this and do something better, right? They have a firm that does all their
cost him money. Like he's literally gonna have to cost him money and like not cost the potential earnings, cost him money. That's what's gonna take. You're fucking up my passive income.
Sure.
Now I'm gonna fire you.
Hey man, I don't know. I want better for everybody, and it's embarrassing.
I do too. But this is capitalism. Like this is what we got.
Capitalism is the worst fucking system ever. I hate this shit in every way.
When you don't have money, it is. When you got money, it's the fucking
It's fucking fire for 19 people. Fuck. God damn, this shit's awful. They ruined the one good thing we like to watch. You know what Jamal probably wants every Sunday? To take a day off his like 70K a year job and just scratch his ass while his team wins some games. And his owner's like, fuck you, you broke bitch, we're losing.
I see why you 32 games. Now too, dog. When you put it that way, I wouldn't stay home for these bitches. Like,
no. I'm not buying a Sunday ticket to watch my team get fucking raw, dog. No.
Dude, yeah, me and Tyrell, what was it, last season? I watched the first game season before. I watched the first game against the Colts.
I didn't see that nigga for a year. He was like, I don't know. Yeah,
we lost like three, four games. Like, the games were like close. Then we started getting smoked out. Like, yeah, let me start working these Sundays and make some extra money. Like, fuck this shit.
Yeah, it ain't worth it.
I can listen to this shit on my phone. Mm-mm. I got fancy football. I can watch Sunday night game or Monday night football.
You could be a Chargers fan where your team tricks you into taking days off of work because you think you're going to win and you get fucking dog walked every week. And then you win the next week. We beat the Super Bowl champions by 40. Speaking of Super Bowl champions, hold on. Yeah, I bought these glasses in honor of Joe Burrow. I'm wearing them to the Super Bowl.
Oh, wow. Are you going?
No, I'm going to wear them at the crib. I'm just going to be instead of a Joe Burrow jersey, we having a little party at the crib, you know. Having some people over.
Having a good time. COVID party, man. See, we can't make a treat.
Hey, all my homies have had COVID now, so I think we're good.
Me and Jamal have never had COVID.
I went to...
Jamal actually did have COVID. He had a fever. Yeah.
I went to... We watched the championship game.
I did get my booster last week. I let him inject me with the 5G.
Man, I can't see you go out like that again. That shit was bad.
I got the booster.
We watched a championship game at one of the homies, or at one of the homies' houses last week. Tuesday, somebody was like, "Hey guys, I got COVID." God damn it, we can't do shit. Yeah.
So you got close contact?
Yeah.
Does that even count? Because you were like, you're within 90 days of having it, right?
Yeah, but I've been sick this week anyway. I just had a little cold, so it didn't matter anyway.
So you sat down on a little, you know, protect your MVC.
You know. Anyway, speaking moving on.
The Super Bowl. Who y'all think will win? Who y'all got for the Super Bowl?
I want the Bengals to win. I think the Rams are going to win, though. They're playing incredible football.
I think the Rams are going to win, and for the same reason that I think Aaron Donald is going to be the Super Bowl MVP, because I don't know what you – like, Von Miller's looked great. Greg Gaines looked great. Aaron Donald's going to fucking absolutely go crazy. Joe Burrow looks awesome. But like, if you put Jalen Ramsey on Jamar Chase and it takes him just a tick longer to get open than it, like it normally does, T. Higgins might go off. But yeah, I think the Rams got this.
You know it's going to be Stafford or Cup. I know y'all got your little sexy little bets going. You know it's going to be Stafford or Cup
to win MVP.
Yes, if they win, it's not going to be. He's going to be like 6 sacks.
Yeah, no. If they win like a low scoring game, like 14-10 or 14-7, Aaron Donald has like 6 sacks and he win it. But that's just going to Stafford.
So if they win 14-6 and Aaron Donald has 6 sacks, he could win it.
Yeah, nah, that, right. That shit. They giving that shit to Stafford.
I agree.
Nigga, didn't Von Miller win MVP when they fucked the Panthers up?
He had a strip sack. He had like 4 sacks and a strip sack.
Cam Newton like on the ground not fighting for the ball. Like, yeah, no, he had.
He might have had 2 strip sacks.
Shit.
Jamal was asleep, so he didn't know.
I was fucking fried.
I also want my LSU NFL team to win, but I think it's going to be hard pressed for them. I think that luck might run out. You ain't giving up 9 sacks and giving the ball back to Matt Stafford and Cooper Kupp and
Walker. Yeah, the Bengals are the pick of the Saints fan base as well. So because the LSU.
Who they and who that?
And Trey Hendrickson and Eli Apple up there doing their thing. I think Von Bell's on that team as well.
Yeah, yes. Odell's an LSU guy.
That's it, though.
And who else?
Oh, and Andrew Whitworth.
Okay, Andrew Whitworth was like my first year watching LSU football. I think. Yeah, maybe even earlier than that. I think it's 46 years old.
You played with Joe Namath down there?
Yeah. No, I'm talking about the guys I wanted a natty with watching that brought me joy in my life. And then I could play with Rohan Davey.
Oh, wow. Nah, Andrew Whitworth is old as fuck. Bro,
Jesus Christ. Old as hell. It's hard to not pick the Rams. I do think the Bengals can cover, though.
You telling me him and Glenn Dorsey used to go heads in practice?
Glenn Dorsey was a high school senior coming on for practices and shit, getting whooped on by him.
Jesus Christ.
I do think it'll be a fun game. I do hope it's high scoring. I think it can be high scoring.
I wonder what they got the over at.
No one got Darian Light, like, dude? My bad.
No.
I do low-key kind of want that shit. I might wait a little bit because I got other stuff I need to beat. But I'm really just waiting on Horizon. That's like, what, 2 weeks from now?
Yep, the 18th, 14 days.
Are you putting yourself on complete media blackout too, like Tyrell?
Oh, I haven't even I haven't muted any like keywords and nothing for that shit, but I guess I should.
I don't mute stuff necessarily. I just, whenever I've already decided I'm going to buy a game, I just try not to look at anything because it's like, I don't even care what the like side missions or the gameplay look like. I just want to be surprised and have a good time when I get it.
Yeah, I think the last thing I watched was that video Blake sent us, like that preview, whatever, kind of like the little 8-minute preview they did.
But yeah,
I don't want to see anymore. Like, I'm good.
I'm excited
for it. I know I'm not going to play it, so I'll watch everything at this point.
Dying Light looks fun. I really didn't like that first one. I've heard that they've improved like the gameplay stuff and like how the zombies work a little bit. The story I also have heard is awful. I might play it once Jamal buys it on sale in like 6 months, but I don't have any desire to get that.
Yeah, it's not my cup of bourbon. Kiss my drink.
Did you play the first one?
I did.
That shit was cheap.
Jamal really played though. I just got through a little bit of that shit.
I fucked with the first one. I think
game fucking sucked.
I played it with like who the hell did I play that shit a lot with?
I think you were playing with like Fly and Lamar or something like that.
Yeah, might have been me and Lamar. I think so. Yeah, that nigga Lamar used to fucking leave me. That nigga just be running off out of nowhere. That shit was hella fun at night when the zombies get like super turned up.
That shit was pretty funny though.
Yeah. Nah, I'm just waiting on Horizon, bro. That's what I'm waiting on.
I got a question for y'all.
I need it.
So tell me what you think is the best feature out of these three songs. Damn. Okay. J-Rock on Money Trees, Pusha T on So Appalled, or Rick Ross on Devil in a New Dress.
Ooh, shit.
It's between the Ross and the J-Rock one for me.
I agree. I'm going to have to pick one.
I think I go Money Trees. I just like that song.
They all bodied that their verses.
I'm going to go with J-Rock too. It's a very close, or Rick Ross on Devil in a New Dress is a very close second.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
I don't really care for Push on So Appalled. I'd have to listen to it just to be sure. I feel like he didn't even have my favorite verse on there.
But like, that's definitely my third favorite out of all those.
So Appalled. Donald Trump, take it. I think Kanye had my favorite verse on there now. I'm thinking about it. Yeah, he didn't have my favorite verse.
Kanye can rap his ass off when he wants to, man. Like,
God, it's ridiculous.
Life of Pablo today, and fucking No More Parties in L.A., like him and Kendrick, like, how do you just wake up and do the shit when you want to do it? You don't do it all the time, but you do it when you want to do it.
I don't understand it. Whatever writer's available that day, I don't know, because I was listening to Life of Pablo last week, and he that album is great. Very great.
Yeah. And then, like on Off the Grid on Donda, he did his shit on there too.
I've only listened to that album a couple times, and I listened to specific
songs. Oh my god! Since The West came out, that's been like one of my heaviest rotation albums.
What's the beat on Off the Grid? I know them by beat, not by name.
I can just do it for you. Hold on,
because that album's so damn long. I like picked a couple songs that I like, and then like, oh, I've heard this beat on TikTok.
Goes off.
Oh, I probably. I do not.
Sorry for Playboy Cardi. Hold on.
That's where I send it to. I was forgetting you. Decide of a living room. Look at the problems and issues I'm living through. They try to drag me. I rise in my pinnacle. Walk through the block like the neighborhood general. Drop me the low end, and that's where I send it to. I was forgetting you. Now I remember.
Nah, don't be listening to that. I hate them fucking drill beats. So if I hear that shit, I'm probably turning it off.
Ah.
I hate those beats.
Speaking of Fivio and drill beats, what'd you say?
Oh, brother.
Fuck Playboy Cardi.
Oh. I know. You tell us every time you get a chance to.
Shakur does make sure if he hates somebody, you will know about it.
Every time. Like, who you got over there? Yeah, I don't fuck with him.
And then once he just started doing that damn baby voice too much, I'm like, I can't listen to this shit anymore.
I can't believe you keep on talking to me about Baby Keem and you mad at baby voices.
Nigga, I don't listen to Baby Keem, but what the fuck are you getting this from?
That's crazy. On one of Fivio's songs, it came out last year. I think it's called A Story or The Story, something like that. But the premise of the song, I don't know if you're familiar with this, like he's like talking about this guy like took a charge for his man's, like he's in jail now. And like, the charge is like some serious shit. Like I guess like they thought he killed a police officer or something like that. But while he's in there, his man's who he took the charge for ends up like getting killed in the streets, right? And so now he's having the thought of like, damn, I should just retrial and like tell the truth now. And he's like, no, I'm gonna sit down and just take the time that they gave me. But, like, if I know we're not like the street like encyclopedias,
yes,
and like that, but like if you wouldn't like retrial and told the truth, is that snitching?
Yes, and I don't care. Yeah. What are they gonna do? Yeah, what are they gonna do? Oh, they dug him up and put him in the they cremated him.
I thought him in the grave.
Fuck no. I might consult the hood just to be like, hey, listen, this is what I'm thinking about doing. Y'all not gonna kill me first.
He gone, hey. I'm just letting y'all know.
Yeah. Nah, nigga, you putting smut on his name. We killing you. Fuck you. Do you think they believe? Do you think they believe you?
Mama head at the grocery store like Stone Cold Steve Austin. You niggas about to be sick. Niggas put my mama through a table.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna call a friend first just to make sure it's okay. But if I have the opportunity and nobody's gonna be mad, nigga, I'm absolute. You know how mad I'd be if I take a charge for a nigga who died, you irresponsible bitch? Oh my god, absolutely not. You better stay alive till I get home. You owe me.
I'm like, dog, you probably should have just called your lawyer to make that retrial. Like,
fuck. Wait,
I know you said that, but nobody cares. Dog.
You said that happened in the song. Did that really happen to him?
I don't think so, because he didn't get locked up that crazy. He was like selling drugs in North Carolina or something.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Man, yeah. Bitch up.
No, yeah, I'm absolutely. If I have any opportunity to get out without it like affecting my name, like if nobody's gonna care, I'm doing mostly whatever.
I feel you. I agree.
Fabio was the Southern Connect for Franklin and the his old ass.
He was in Little Rock with Jerome and him.
Yeah, that was actually Fabio.
Hey, that comes out later this month too. We getting Snowfall back at the end of the month. Can't wait for that.
Someone said they mad at Franklin because he's not limping no more. He's
faking. He did like your dog when they step on something, they just fake limp for like the next 5 hours.
Oh my god.
He really dropped the cane at the end, like, ah, gotcha, bitch.
Mm-hmm.
He's walking like
all right.
Yeah.
No, he wasn't. He only got one joke for people who be walking. You gonna be a linebacker? Yes, it was.
Yeah, I can't think of his name. What's bro name?
Thank God. We don't know. Never heard of him. Never heard of him.
Nigga, I hate to say without Manboy, though.
I can't think of his name.
Manboy's a great actor.
He was on the Throwing Bones thing with Draymond Green. They had him on there.
That's hella funny. Oh, they said on the Cali game. They said on Cali gangbanging that Draymond Green be getting taxed to move around the city. And I was said that, they be saying it to make fun of people. But I'm like, yo, if I'm hella rich and I just gotta pay somebody like $4,500 for a month for nobody to fuck with me ever in a place where people will absolutely fuck with me all the time, I'm gonna be. You're not about to make me sound like no sucker. Like, what the fuck?
I got a max contract. Suck my dick. Take this. Yeah,
I understand, though. Like, you're only going to get taxed if you're going into certain areas. Like, that's only a thing. Like, extortion only exists in certain areas.
Have
you
seen
that much money? Why do you want to go over there? You don't got to go over there.
Have you seen Draymond Green's face?
Hey, sometimes niggas just want
to
kick
Draymond Green has a face that he looks like he likes to be around trouble.
You might, but now you profile him.
He's from Saginaw and be slapping niggas in the club. He probably want to just be out in like the dirtiest parts of Oakland, like getting into it.
Yeah, he's athlete, peak veteran, bro.
Yo, we need
he's part of the rare club. Him, Brett Favre, Jamal Murray.
Oh, wow.
Greg Oden.
Oh, shit. Or somebody said his dick was that shit.
Call it a nigga meat pit veteran. It's fucking insane.
Holy shit.
It's hella funny too, because the two times that NBA players have like publicly posted their meat, he did it at the Olympics and Jamal Murray did it in the bubble. Like, you're just in an enclosed space where NBA players the next day are definitely clowning you.
You leaving Greg Oden off of this.
I don't. Where was Greg Oden? What was he at the Olympics too?
This happened when I was on Twitter still. Greg Oden let the meat hang.
I didn't know he did that. Blake was got a file.
I had a good memory.
They could do a pro player cops.
It's not every day that an athlete can hang a dog on the timeline. Like,
for Atlanta drop. I said we need that as a drop. You have that?
No.
This nigga gay as hell.
That's the only one I have semi.
That show comes out next month too, Atlanta.
Athlete's dropping cock. Oh fuck!
Wow.
You niggas are nuts.
That is a disgusting act by Randy Moss.
They were so mad at him when he mooned.
Joe Buck sounded like he wanted to shoot him in the back of the head.
Holy shit.
Cover the eyes of the mothers.
That is a disgusting act. Oh my god.
I thought I had the casting on us one too, but
so you gotta watch the Pro Bowl this weekend?
I'm not watching it, but I did bet on it. I'm not watching that shit.
I'm about to put some money on it too.
Are you gonna be home to watch it, Jamal? Like, real talk?
It's Sunday, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
I'll be home.
He takes Sundays off when the Jags aren't playing. He's like, oh, they got a bye. I'm staying home today. I don't want
to
look.
They asked me if I wanted to work this Sunday, but I'm off Sunday, Monday. I ain't giving up my consecutive days off. I'm cool.
Back to video games real quick. Either of y'all play? Blake, you told us what you've been playing. Shakur, you been playing anything recently?
I played Deathloop a little bit this week. I've been playing Arkham City.
Mm. Doesn't Arkham Knights come out in the next couple of months?
It's this or year. Gotham Knight, you know
that. Oh, they don't have a date for it.
It's this year, yeah. No, I've been going through some of those old Batman games.
Let's fake that we're going to all play it together when it comes out.
Hmm? Who's going to be who?
I don't know. Who you going to be?
Which one of them was assholes? I'm going
to kick off you, bro. That's what you be doing to me.
You say what? I'm going to kick off you, bro.
That's who you going to be? All right, cool.
I'm about to be Red Hood. They got guns.
All right, you know it's gonna be like the guns where they do like the Devil May Cry guns where you just be doing like combos with the shits. So you hit someone like 60 times with the 9mm and never reload.
Nah, you stupid. You're probably right. Who's gonna be Robin?
Which one? You talking about bisexual Robin, aren't you? Because that's what you would do right now. I know that's what you would do.
Why are you so horny? What is happening with him?
I'm about to be Barbara Gordon in a wheelchair kicking ass.
Oh my god!
Oh, like Titans got a. I think they renewed the season, but they said I think they a
goddamn mistake. Let that shit die.
Come on, man, relax. Oh,
they make half a season really good and then just fuck it up.
Yo, you explained that episode where they were like all dead but not dead. Pissed me off.
Oh, Nick, yo, somebody
Tyrell, you gotta see how this shit ended though with the purple rain. And then the song came on.
Shout out to Future.
Like Prince?
Yes.
Nigga. What the fuck? Somebody on Twitter said Hawk turned into Yusuke Urameshi. Thought that shit had me dying. Nah, that was
bullshit. Cut ass reference. You don't know what that is.
In, a diner in Purgatory. You never watched a Yu Hakusho show?
No, I did.
I haven't watched a Peacemaker though. That show's funny as hell.
That show's hilarious.
You caught up? Everybody caught up?
Yeah. No, I'm 2 episodes behind. I think I started when they were already on like episode 4 or something. Ain't nothing on the show spoiler worthy. If y'all want to talk about it, that's fine. I don't give a fuck.
There actually is though. Especially relating to people on the team.
Okay. Oh, well, yeah, I plan on watching them this weekend, probably tomorrow. So eat a dick.
I think Jamal fucks with Peacemaker's dad and the jokes he's making.
You know he does. Jamal is the biggest racist I've ever met. That motherfucker has watched Gran Torino 76 times. Homelander his favorite character, and Stormfront his second favorite character. And now he wants a white knight outfit for Halloween.
Jamal definitely engaged with racism as a form of comedy.
That was hilarious.
It's like a form of comedy or a form of love. I don't know.
That nigga's really just the white knight.
That's why that nigga can't go to Canada no more.
The costume? Yeah, his dad has?
That costume is ass.
That shit was kind of trash. What the
fuck is he? It's like a dead goat head.
It's supposed to be a dragon. Yeah, the white dragon.
Hey, I wasn't expecting Vigilante. I did see the episode where Vigilante goes up to the niggas in the jail and starts assaulting them. He beat the brakes off the niggas. White knight was like, whoa, not me, buddy. I'm out of here. Guard!
Nah, he was
fucking ass.
I ain't seen an ass whooping like that on since the first episode of season 2 of The Punisher, where he whooped them 2 bitches in the bathroom.
Yo. Oh my god.
Nah, he fucked them whole up.
Man. He like paper towel to Spencer's like,
he broke one chick's head on the sink. She like tried to stab him. He grabbed her arm, broke it, took the knife from her, stabbed her in the shoulder to the stall and was just packing her out. I was like,
God, he was like, all right, y'all ain't in the universe. Get the fuck out of here.
Yo, wow, that is...
No. Matt Murdock, you ever watch that?
Tyrell, you never watched that?
No.
You just need to watch... Maybe
that one of the Netflix ones?
Yeah, you just need to watch the last 8 minutes of season 2, episode 1. Nigga, he stabbed the bitch to the stall and is just packing her out. It's the most violent shit I think I've ever seen.
Y'all go watch the last episode of Defenders 2 and see him fighting inside the middle of some dragon bones and electric and turn into like a cloud of smoke and shit. Like,
dude, I didn't finish Defenders, dude, because that show, man. Did you watch a dragon? What, dragon? Not Dragon.
Iron Fist.
Yeah, Iron Fist. There we go.
I watched all the Netflix things. I watched. Besides, I didn't finish Luke Cage season 2. It's the only thing I didn't finish.
Damn, you didn't finish the black one. That's crazy.
Yeah, because that one personally
offended me. Did you just dab? Get the fuck out of
here. I think after he dabbed, everybody we know turned that fucking series off after they made that nigga dab.
A bad show don't hurt as much when it's not trying to
coon it up. Right word?
Season one.
It kind of talked to me.
I like season one.
Season one was good as fuck.
Dude, man, like, they were so close.
Cottonmouth was a good ass character. They were like, you get 4 episodes.
Yeah. You couldn't afford his ass.
I thought Wolfman was about to get naked on there in season two. The Misty Knight.
Yeah.
Chick on there that he was messing with. Like, dude, like, they got super close to, like, showing a titty. But then, like, nah, she never got naked on there.
Oh,
she
come on, fun. Titty.
Hold the Issa Rae.
What about Issa Rae?
She be pump faking on there.
Oh, yeah. Like,
arm right here.
they be talented as hell with them angles. Like, how the arm go right in front of the nipple.
When it's your show, you going to make sure it's right.
Hey, but it's funny because you be thinking they're going to do that on every show. You watch a Euphoria, and the next thing you know, there's just a dick on your screen. Like, yo,
hey, I heard those aren't real dicks. I heard
they don't look like real dicks.
You upset?
Actually. Wait,
what? Kind of... Come on, man. Why you trying to do me like that?
why'd you find that news for us?
And why'd you say it so fast? I said dicks on the screen. Those are fake dicks. Oh, those dicks are not real.
The dicks ain't real.
Did the math. No dick is that girthy.
Wow. All right. Relax.
Hey, yo. Okay. Yo.
This thing is wild. Come on.
Hold on a minute, player.
We ain't no freaks. We ain't no homo. No, don't do it, though.
What kind of your favorite character?
Till we ain't never pulled no train. We ain't no motherfucking freaks. We some family men. Mm. We getting it paper. You know what I'm talking about?
The end of that last episode was wild, dude. Like, that, like, the nigga's dad was like, you know what? I'm such and such, the F word. I'm a pig. But you guys are fucking weird. And then he said,
I fucking hate all of you. Fuck your mom. Remember, she used to suck my dick and I didn't even like it. Nah, you can't even say.
Nigga, Euphoria.
Oh, shit.
No, I only watched the first episode of the season because I seen a clip of what was going on in the second one. I was like, dog, this is like fucking porn. Like, I'm not about to watch this shit.
Nah, they start the second episode. Dog, Nate's dad is... you just gotta watch the show.
Yeah, I forgot about watch the show.
I will say, though, Fez's little brother, Ashtray, just need to watch it so you can see Ashtray be the realest nigga of all time on TV. He beat the fuck out of his dad.
That first episode was some wild shit that I feel like should be shown to kids if they're trying to keep them away from, like, drugs and selling drugs and everything. Like,
nigga, people were like, oh, this show is glorifying sex and drugs. If you watch that show and you think that's glorifying, you need fucking help. That's a good way to find out if your kid needs help. If they think that shit's lit. Because that show don't glorify shit.
Hell no. With how they show Rue going through it and just, like, how fucked up she is, like, even if high schoolers were to watch the show, I don't feel like it would make them want to do drugs. That shit seems scary.
But it might make them want to suck some dick, but not do no drugs.
Bro, she was like, there's my heart rate. I found it. I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah, nigga, what? Yeah, nah. Every episode is good. There'd just be like 10-minute stretches where it's like, I am incredibly uncomfortable.
Yeah, it'd
be Jamal, you just gonna let Tyrell just sneak out that the show gives him dick sucking urges. You didn't catch that, did you?
Wait, what? What did he say?
He literally said. He said the show might make him want to suck some dick. That's what he said.
I said them. You know what they? Because you said it's not going to make kids want to do drugs, and I said, yeah, it might make them want to suck some dick, but it's not going to make them want to do drugs. I want to do drugs watching the show. I'm about to do fentanyl as soon as we turn this show off.
Hey, yo, I think I'm about to get up out of here now. That nigga take the word.
Yeah. You should deteriorate quickly.
I have nothing else to mention. I just want people to be I don't want people to miss me.
Nigga, miss that. Yeah. You mentioned that ESTG.
I'm pulling from half court.
What's the ESTG song you said you were fucking with?
Well, he smoked that song on Blockboy JB. That shit was hard.
No, you said Babyface Ray. He's like 6 Mile or something.
That's the best song on that album.
Actually, no, I know what I'm gonna play for a fucking outro, man.
You gotta play 6 Mile. I've listened to that song 40 times in the last like.
Well, I've never heard it, so I don't know how it works on an outro. But I have one of mine that I've listened to.
Hey, man, I trust you.
All right.
Whisper and told.
Oh, that's a good one. Huh?
only one.
Yeah, we had to get out of here. Tyrell's our wild.
All right, episode 45, man. Watch before you with your mouth closed. Don't fall for that shit.
All right, wow.
We out of here.